Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine Latulip, and today I'm going to introduce you to for loops in processing. So you've already learned about while loops, and what you might have noticed is that while loops are often just counting through some things. So in this example, we have int I initialized to 1, and then we're looping through while I is less than 10, adding to I each time. And so I is actually a counter variable here, and it becomes 2 and then 3, etc. And the while loop stops when I gets big enough that this condition is no longer true. Well, you may wonder, is there an easier way to write this? And let's first think about what the components are. We've got four parts. We have the initialization code, we have the condition, we have the loop body, and we have this upkeep or stepped part where we're incrementing or changing our counter in some way. So the for loop basically lets you write all this in a condensed form. You're not doing anything new. It doesn't allow you to do anything you couldn't do before. It's a while loop in disguise, but it's more compact. So here's the syntax. We have the keyword for, we have our four parts, the initialization, the expression. So the initialization, and then we have a semicolon. And then we have our condition or expression. This has to be a Boolean condition. And while it's true, the body is going to be executed. And then we have the upkeep or the step, the thing that changes our counter variable. And then, of course, we have the body typically inside of curly braces. So that's the syntax for the for loop. And it may look a little daunting at first, but you'll get used to it really quickly. So here's an example. Here's our while loop. And this is the exact same loop converted to a for loop. So we have the keyword for, here's our initialization line, which is the same as up here. Here's our test or our condition, I less than or equal to 10. These are both separated with semicolons, ended with semicolons. And then we have our upkeep, I equals I plus 1. There's no semicolon after it though, because we've got this curly bracket here, or sorry, round bracket here that says we're done with the for loop header stuff. This is usually referred to as the for loop header, this whole line here. And then we have our body, and this is the same as here. So the difference here is that our body up here in the while loop is sort of cluttered with the upkeep of the counter. And in here, the body is only the things that we want executed while the condition is true. So this is what we call a count controlled loop, and I is our counter. And for loops look very much like this a lot of the time. Often we have int I as the counter. It's a really sort of common standard in programming. So it's important to note what things happen when. The first time we come to this for loop line, we're going to do the initialization step. Then we'll check the condition. If the condition is true, we execute the body. Every time after we've executed the body, we do the upkeep step, and then the whole thing repeats. Importantly though, the initialization doesn't happen every time. It only happens the first time. So when we come up here the second time, we skip the initialization, we check our condition. If it's still true, we do the body, we do the upkeep, and then we come back and we do it again. Skip the initialization, check the condition. If it's true, do the body, do the upkeep, and then repeat. At some point we're going to come up here, we're going to check the condition, and it's actually going to be false. And at that point, we skip doing the body, we skip the upkeep step, and we jump down and start executing whatever statements come after the for loop. So initialization is only done once. The condition is checked before each time we go through the loop, which is also known as an iteration. The upkeep is done at the end of each iteration. The body is executed during each iteration if the condition is true. And the statements after the loop will be done once this condition is false. Okay, a few additional things about this. The braces, just like with if statements and while loops, the braces, these curly braces, are not required if you only have one line of code in here. I always think it's a good idea to just put them in anyways, just as a matter of habit. You don't put a semicolon after the upkeep, so don't do that because it'll cause problems. This condition, just like with a while loop or with an if statement, this condition has to be a Boolean expression that can evaluate to true or false. And finally, these statements here, the initialization and the upkeep, Generally, you want them to be quite simple assignment statements where you're declaring and initializing a variable over here, and you're assigning a new value to a variable over here, usually incrementing or decrementing. Don't do things like put an if statement in here or put an if statement in there. All right, so you can count in a lot of different ways with these for loops. So we can count down instead of up. In this for loop, we're initializing I to 10. We're checking that I is greater than or equal to 1, and we're decrementing I by 1 each time. So this will count down 10, 9, 8, etc. Until I is 1, it will print 1, and then I will become 0. It will come up here, and this will be false. We can count by 2s in this type of loop. So int I equals 1, int I is less than or equal to 10, and here I equals I plus 2. So we're incrementing not by 1, but by 2 using this form. So this would count 1, 3, 5, 7, etc. One of the things to be really careful of and to completely avoid is using floats in your for loops as the counter. So you can have floats in the body of your for loop, but using floats like this is really problematic. So these two things look identical or very similar, right? Here we have, we're counting from x equals 1 up to 10, incrementing by 1 each time. So this prints the values 1 to 10. And here it looks like we're doing pretty much the same thing, but with floating point values from 0.1 up to 1, incrementing by 0.1. So this should theoretically give us 0.1, 0.2, etc. But this is going to cause us problems. So here's what the first one looks like when we're using integers, counts up to 10, no problem. Here is what the second one looks like. When we're using floats, we end up with these numbers that are not what we're expecting here. And that is because the way computers store floating point numbers, we can get strange rounding and precision errors, and that can cause us real problems in terms of when this condition becomes true or false if these things start compounding. So you never want to do that. Instead, what you want to do is convert your loop counter variable to integers and then convert that to a float inside the loop when you want to do something with it. So instead of this, you do something like this. So we create an int counter, we call it steps. So we go from I equals 0 up to 10, and we increment by 1. And then inside here, we divide our I by the steps, so I over 10, to get a float and print that out. Now note here that in order to carefully avoid integer division, which would always just give us 0, we've converted our steps to a float so that we're actually going to get a decimal value here. And so this then looks like this. Okay, float divided by 10, and we're actually getting decimal numbers out. All right, so here's a couple of simple numeric examples. This for loop will print out the odd numbers from 3 to 17. So we start at 3, we go up to 17, we just add 2 each time, and that will do something like this, okay? Here's a loop that will print multiples of 5 from 65 down to 15. So here we're starting at 65, initializing our value, checking that I is greater than or equal to 5 because we're counting down, and we're decrementing by 5 each time, and that will look like this. Here's a more advanced example. This is drawing using a for loop, and this is the grid example. And so what we actually want to do is go over and look at this in processing. So here's our grid example, and we are setting a canvas size to 500. We decide that if we want 8 squares across and 8 squares down, we need lines, we need 9 lines in order to get 8 squares. And then we have a for loop that starts at I equals 0. It counts up to I is less than n, the number of lines that we want, and increments by 1. And then we're calculating a position based on the width. The x position is based on the width of the canvas minus 1, And then multiplying by I, which is our number, divided by our big number minus 1. So this is giving us an x position, this is giving us a y position, and then we're using that to draw a line. So this top line goes from 0 to width minus 1 at y position, so that's the horizontal line. This next one is from x position 0 to x position height minus 1, so that's a vertical line. And so we'll do this, and this is basically giving us our spacing each time. And we will run this, and we'll see that we get this grid. And if we change the n and we say, well, actually, let's set it to 15 so that we get a whole bunch of smaller squares, you'll see now that we've got a different kind of grid. It's a much finer grid. So this is an example of how to use a for loop to count. And this is actually counting across and counting down in some ways. It's just counting the number of lines we need to make the grid and then making some calculations using width and spacing, because each time we need to add a little bit more spacing to get the x and y positions. All right, so that's an example of using a for loop to draw a grid. We can also recall our scaling formula and use that to change things in a for loop. So just to remind you, if we have a number in a source destination and the source range is source min to source max, and we need a corresponding number, answer, in another range, destination min to destination max, we use this formula. So answer equals the destination min plus this thing, which is basically source minus source min divided by the range in the source. So this gives us the source percentage in some sense. And then we multiply it by destination max minus destination min, which is the range in our destination. And so we can use this to get colors, and that's what we do here in the example of morphing. So color morph is going to take colors that are initially purple and slowly change the red, green, and blue values until we get to the point where it's more like this greenish turquoise color. Okay, we're going to do this in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We're going to do this in 8 steps. So we have 8 different blocks here, and each block is going to be a successive change or morph in all 3 of the colors, the R, G, and B. So let's have a look at what this code looks like. Here's our color morph code. And you'll see we've got, to get this wide window, we've got a wider size canvas and a not very tall canvas. We've got our num steps, which is how many different things we want to do. So that num steps is going to end up being the maximum. It's part of our condition in our for loop. So we're going to draw rectangles num steps times, starting at 0. Then we have some variables like bar height, so how tall this is, and bar width, how wide this is, and we're just taking the width of the window and dividing it by those steps to get, make this spread across the window. And then we have an initial red value, an initial green value, and an initial blue value, and these give us that initial purple at this side, and we have a final red, final green, and final blue. These give us that final greenish color. And now we have our for loop. So we're going from 0 to num steps, but not including num steps. So this is basically doing 8 blocks because we're going from 0 to 7. So this will be block where I is 0. This will be the block where I is 1. This will be the block where I is 2, etc. And at each time we go through this loop, we're going to calculate the position, which is where we start drawing our block. And then we're going to use our scaling value to figure out the red value, the green value, and the blue value. So here we're taking init red, we're adding final red minus init red times the position. And so our position here is basically saying, how far along are we in the window? So here we're not very far on the window. Here we're a little bit further, etc. So here, this is about halfway along the window. And so here we're going to be halfway between our min red or init red and our final red. And so that's how we get that scaled color for each of the three red, green, and blue values. Then we use them to do our fill, and we set the stroke to be the same. And then we draw our rectangle. And again, to draw the rectangle, to get it in the right place, we're having to use I times bar width. So the first time I is going to be 0, so 0. The next time we come through here, I is going to be 1, and so we're going to do 1 times bar width, and so the second rectangle will be drawn from here over. And the height is going to be the same each time, and the bar width and bar height. So this is how we get these colors to morph, and if we run this, we can see this here, and it's quite pretty. And one of the things that we ask is, do you see an optical illusion here? It's kind of fun, because for these blocks, it looks like it's lighter over here and more purpley over here, but it's actually an optical illusion. If you cover up all of this and cover up all of this, you'll see that this is actually one solid color. All right, so that's a couple more examples of for loops, and I hope that gives you a good sense of how we might use for loops in a variety of different ways. All right, thanks for watching.